Welcome back, guys. Well, in this episode, we're going to be kicking off a multi-part series where we're going to be modifying a home-built computer based around the 6502 processor. Well, if you don't know what the 6502 processor is, that's okay. You're probably familiar with some of the devices that it once powered back in the 70s and the 80s. It powered devices like the BBC Micro. Many Atari systems were powered by it. A lot of the Apple devices like the Apple II. The Nintendo Entertainment System was powered by it. And even the T-800 from the Terminator movies was powered by the 6502. It's true. If you go and look in the movie, they have 6502 assembler code right there in the HUD. The computer that we're going to be modifying in these videos is available as a kit from a guy named Ben Eater. And you might want to check out Ben's channel over here. He has a lot of amazing electronics projects on his YouTube channel, such as building an 8-bit computer from scratch, building a video card from scratch, and the 6502 computer kit that we're going to be modifying. If you're at all interested in following along and maybe building some of this on your own, I highly suggest heading over to Ben's channel and maybe picking yourself up one of his 6502 kits. Initially, the circuit that we're going to be building today will be integrated into the 6502 in a later video, so you have some time to get it together. So the late 1970s must have been a magical time to be alive for computer nerds. The computer scene around that time was really geared specifically for computer nerds. For most people, the computer was pretty much unusable. With no monitor and only a few switches and LEDs for input and output, people had a real hard time understanding it, and it required a deep understanding of how computers worked just to be able to use the things. So for most people, they couldn't see how the computer would eventually change society forever. But it wasn't too long after that that computers became usable, and they started showing up in homes and offices all over the world. The things we take for granted today, like being able to store large amounts of data, it was difficult back then, and they were expensive and they were hard to come by. But that's where BYTE magazine came in. They sponsored a symposium back in November of 1975 in Kansas City, Missouri. 18 people were invited to that, and the goal of it was to come up with a way to store computer data on common everyday cassette audio tapes. Audio tapes were widely available and low cost, so it made sense that that's what they would want to focus on. The result of that symposium was a standard that ended up being referred to by a few different names. It was called the Kansas City Standard, or also the BYTE Standard. And BYTE published that in their sixth publication back in February of 1976, and we can find that in here on pages 72 and 73. So here's the article pulled directly from BYTE magazine. This is the exact information that some of the people would have seen and read back in 1976. So in here, we should be able to find everything we need to know about how to read data off a cassette tape. But before we get started, I wanted to quickly point out the people that were a part of the symposium in Kansas City where they defined the standard. These people were all passionate about computers, and you'll probably recognize one of their names. So if we read through the article, we'll find that they mentioned some of the requirements that the standards should meet. The main goal of the project was to create a standard that was designed to work with inexpensive equipment available to all consumers. And if we read further, we'll find the juicy details that we're looking for right smack in the middle. In here, we'll see that they define that data will be modulated using frequency shift modulation, also known as FSK. We'll also see that data is coming in at 300 baud. A mark, or a logical one, consists of 8 cycles at 2400 Hz. A space, or a logical zero, is 4 cycles at 1200 Hz. And a fully recorded character, or a byte, will start with a zero as a start bit, followed by 8 data bits, and then 2 or more ones as stop bits. It also says that the interval between characters, or our bytes, is unspecified, the amount of time. So this means that the timing between our characters, it doesn't really matter. As long as we have our start bits and our stop bits, our circuit should be able to discern the difference between our bytes. The next part says that data should be coming in with the least significant bit first and then the most significant bit last. So keep this in mind as we look at our oscilloscope screens, because the data will appear to be coming in backwards. It's easy to forget this, and this definitely caught me off guard a few times. Also note that the standard allows for an optional parity bit. Those familiar with it may notice that this is a fairly standard UART stream. The last part we should look at is right here. It mentions that the data shouldn't be recorded on tape until 30 seconds has passed the leader. This is supposedly to help with backlash or play that the tapes experience when they first start playing, but we also may be able to use this information to reset a counter to know when we've started a new data stream. I don't really know yet if we'll use it, because as of this recording, I haven't built that part of the circuit yet. So let's visualize what we've learned and take a look at what this might look like. We learned that the audio coming in will be modulated using FSK, or Frequency Shift Modulation, or Keen. FSK is a method of transmitting digital signals using discrete frequency changes. So as we look at our audio signal, you'll notice that there are different frequencies represented. We see parts of the wave that are spread out, which is the lower frequency, and parts that are closer together, this is our higher frequency. The article said that a 1, or a mark, is at 2400 Hz, and that a 0, or a space, is at 1200 Hz. So that means here are our 1s and these are our 0s. It mentioned that a fully recorded character is a 0 as a start bit, 8 data bits, and then 2 or more 1s as stop bits. So here's our full character, or byte. If we remember that this is coming in with the least significant bit first, we can read it this way and find that this character is a hexadecimal 55, also known as 85 in decimal. So we now know what the audio will look like, but what will this look like after it's been fully demodulated into something that's usable for our computer? After sending this through our circuit, we should have something that looks like this, a square wave that varies between 0 and 5 volts. Once we have it in this form, we'll need to do something with it to organize it and ensure that it's ready for our computer. But for now, for this video, let's just focus on getting it to this point. Let's take this to the next level and talk about the actual theory behind demodulating this incoming signal. We need a way to generate ones and zeros depending on the frequency that's currently being played. And with data coming in at 300 baud, this also needs to happen rather quickly. When I initially attempted to build this, I had tried to utilize some standard tone decoders based on the LM567 for the frequency detection. I was trying to use two of them to pick out the frequency and output a 1 or a 0, depending on the tone. Makes sense, right? But I wasn't having much luck and I was getting inconsistent results. I believe this was due to the response time of the LM567 just being too slow for this specific application, since the frequency changes so quickly. But it was months ago, and honestly, the issues could have been one of many other issues with my setup that I ran into. I'll be covering some of those issues in the next video. Well, after many evenings of failure and frustration, I came across a retro build for the Hackaday Retro Challenge in 2018-19 by a guy named Mats Engstrom. For his entry, he built a Kansas City viewer that would take in Kansas City standard audio and output the characters to a home-built 7-segment LED. It's an awesome project, and to make it even more awesome, he did this using only transistors. Well done, man. After looking at how he accomplished this, not only did he solve my issue, but he also made his schematics available on GitHub. So, we're going to be stealing his method to convert or demodulate the Kansas City standard audio. So let's use this again to represent our sine wave coming in from our cassette deck. In this case, it's my computer. For troubleshooting, I created tones using the tone generator in Audacity. Each tone lasts for 5 seconds, and Audacity is looping the playback to allow us to have constant tones coming through as we build our circuit. If we output this to our circuit, this is what it'll look like on our oscilloscope. Our circuit can't do much with this in this format, because digital circuits generally don't like to play nicely with sine waves. Digital circuits like very definitive states, like on or off, or 0 volts and 5 volts. The problem with the sine wave is that the voltage very gradually changes from one state to another. It's in the middle part of that transition that we can have issues, you know, where the state is not quite 0 or not quite 1. It's too unpredictable what the circuit will do when near the center. So what we want to do is change the shape of the sine wave to more of a square so that those transitions happen much more quickly. We'll do this by building a voltage comparator. Basically, a voltage comparator will look at the voltage and either output a full on or a full off. No middle ground. This means that the voltage comparator will output a full 0 volts when below the middle part of the sine wave, and then output 5 volts when above the middle part of the sine wave. When we run our sine waves through something like this, it looks like this yellow line. Notice how the rise and falls of the wave are much quicker than the sine wave, and forms corners instead of gradual transitions. Now that we have our nice, beautiful square waves, we can now attempt to detect our frequencies. We're going to do this by using something called a re-triggerable monostable timer, and we'll actually be using two of them. I'd like to introduce you to a fine gentleman named Mr. Monostable. Mr. Monostable, while he looks refined, is actually quite unstable. You see, Mr. Monostable is normally feeling quite well when he's outputting his high state, but when he's triggered, he becomes unstable, outputting a low, and it takes him some time to start feeling better again, or to output high again. In this example, Mr. Monostable is only comfortable when he's in his high state. Once high, he'll stay there until he's triggered again, and because we're working digitally, he only outputs high or low. There's no middle ground here. If he's re-triggered before reaching his stable state, his timer is immediately reset and he'll remain in his unstable state. The amount of time that it takes him to reach his stable state can be controlled with merely a capacitor and a resistor, so changing the values of these will change the timing of the timer. So if we put a Mr. Monostable here, just after the sine to square wave converter, and use a 100 nanofarad capacitor and a 22K resistor, we will have configured it to stay in its stable state any time there are short pulses, or our high frequency. The lower frequency tones, or the longer wavelengths, will actually just pass right through this monostable, as this monostable won't be triggered in time. Take a look at what the output of this first monostable looks like. As we predicted, you'll see the steady state, and then we'll see the pulse of the lower frequencies, which will actually be passed on to our next monostable. Using the same concept, we can now capture the lower frequency tones by putting another Mr. Monostable right here. Except for this one, we'll change out the capacitor and the resistor to adjust the timing. In this monostable, I used a 100 nanofarad capacitor and an 82K resistor. Take a look at the red line here. If we now feed our alternating signal through this, we'll notice that the output of this monostable is high when the frequency is high, and that the output is low when the frequency is low. This is exactly what we want. So we're now at a fun point in our project where our circuit should be able to output some data. So let's feed some Kansas City Standard encoded audio through our circuit and feed it a hexadecimal 55. If we feed that audio through our circuit, we'll see a familiar shape like what we saw earlier on in the video on the output of this monostable. Notice here where we can see the initial start bit, the 8 data bits, don't forget to read them backwards, and the stop bits. This is our standard UART stream. She's beautiful, isn't she? I think she'll fit in nicely around here, and we're going to use her to feed the next part of our circuit where we will actually latch or hold on to the data in our next video. Thank you so much for sticking around and making it this far into the video. If this is something you enjoyed or you think you have a friend that may enjoy it, please consider clicking the subscribe button or sharing this video with your friend. It really does help a lot, and it'll also help make sure you don't miss the next parts where we latch on to the data and then we integrate the circuit into our 6502 computer. I also have a few other projects coming up, not related to Kansas City Audio, related to modifying the 6502 that I think you'll really find interesting, to say the least. Something I'm currently considering is, if there's enough community support for it, is putting together a kit so that people don't have to source these parts all on their own. If that's something you're interested in, please drop a comment below just to help me gauge what kind of interest is out there. If there's enough interest, I'll put some together and I'll put updates in the video description and also on my website, gregorystrike.com. Also, speaking of links, anything that I mentioned in the video or anything that I think you may find useful, I'll be sure to put in the description, so be sure to check those out. This has been a lot of fun. It's been a lot of work. I am so grateful that you're here. Thank you so much, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.